Are we live?
Yes, we are. Ladies and gentlemen, Shakaijin and salarymen, welcome back to another episode of Bento Bureau, the show where we talk about Japan from an international perspective. As always, I'm your host, Basim Hijazi. You can call me Buzz. And with me, as always, is my fellow co-hosts, Mr. Long Nguyen from Vietnam and Bastian Harth from Germany.
Bastian,
are you there? I think we're having an issue with your video there. Bastian, can you hear us? Apologies, ladies and gentlemen. Sometimes this happens with our setup here. Let me just see if I can tune him in here. Oh, Bastian, we can see you. Bastian.
Hello, Bastian.
Can you hear us, Bastian?
Oh, are you trying to say something?
Okay, hold on. Let me try to bring you back in again. Bastian, can you hear us? Make it count, play it straight. Don't look back, don't hesitate. When you go big time. What you want, what you feel. All right, I'm going to stop that actually because none of you can hear what's going on, but the stream can. Basically, he's singing a song. I were joking, ladies and gentlemen. I'm pulling your leg. Folks, Bastian isn't with us this time, unfortunately. He said he had very urgent business to attend to. What did he say, Long?
I think he has a very important golf meeting with the Bundestag members. I think they're going to discuss some very important issues related to world politics and golf. We should wish them luck because I think this is going to be a very important discussion that they will be requiring a lot of his energy to get this.
I wish him the best of luck. By the way, Long, you're still having a few issues with your mic there, so I suggest you try and figure that out. Turn off that RTX voice or something. But in the meantime, in all seriousness, ladies and gentlemen, last time we were on the show, we took a journey down with a friend of ours who happens to be a huge car enthusiast. You know him as Beatty. He gave us a little taste of what the car scene is like in Japan and streamed his entire journey, showing the local hub of sorts, where he showed us the ins and outs of that sort of thing. And if you haven't seen it, check out our Facebook page. It's the full replays up on there. But this time, as you can see right now, we're joined by two lovely guests who are going to be talking about the Mongolian community in Japan. Ladies and gentlemen, today's guests here to join us are Oyunhyuu and Undariya. I'm going to be calling them Oyun and Unda for short. There they are. Wave to the audience, friends. How's it going? Let everyone see that you're alive and well. Right off the bat, some facts about these two lovely people. Oyun, you are a career consultant that's been working for a very interesting company known as GTN, the Global Trust Network. Now, I imagine many of our audience members who are watching this, who happen to be foreigners living in Japan, are probably familiar with this company. I can definitely say the same. They've made my first few years living in Japan a much smoother one, thanks to the support they offer. Yes, indeed, good times. That Ichiman en was well spent. It's pretty awesome. Thanks for helping us clueless foreigners how to live in Japan. But in all seriousness, thanks for being on the show, Oyun. We'll get to you in a second, but I'm going to introduce Unda now. You are currently the English editor and journalist working for the Mongolian Economy, which I believe is available, as you said to me earlier before this call, it's available in two languages, which is Mongolian and English. Am I correct here in saying that?
That's right.
That's right. All right. And of course, you're the correspondent for Japan, so you focus on Japan as a whole. Of course, your journalistic experience expands across a multitude of years, as I can see here from your bio, writing and reporting news articles, editorial features, and conducting interviews in the field. Now, together, you're both Mongolians who've had experiences living and working in Japan. You know, I'm really excited to have this episode, actually, because in my 5 years living in Japan or so, the only Mongolian that I actually got to know was you, Oyun. But I never really got around to learning more about that community, I feel. And I've always felt like that was a wasted opportunity. I never felt like I sat down and talked to you about that. I always feel like there's an untold story for a lot of these enclaves. And, you know, I'm really interested to hear both of your insights on that today. But before I ask my first question, I kind of want to have a discussion with Long about this, about initial impressions, I guess. Long, You know, when we think of the Mongolian community in Japan, what comes to your mind? Because, you know, if I just think off the top of my head, I think of sumo, which is kind of weird. Sumo. Maybe it comes off because, you know, based on what I've seen, Mongolians actually seem to dominate the sumo industry. I think I was reading somewhere that like three of the four leading sumo wrestlers are Mongolians. Yeah, and you know, maybe you guys can jump in and correct me on that, but that's based on what I read. I also think of IT because I know Japan was going out of their way like about 2 years ago, maybe starting, where they were kind of, they're going to look for Mongolian tech talent, trying to get on board them here because, you know, it seemed like there was a booming industry coming from there as well as other countries in Europe, in Eastern Europe. What do you think, Long? What comes to your mind?
Well, to be honest, up until now, I would say nothing comes to my mind. And it's not in like a really negative way, but it's more like for my whole adult life, growing up, I have never had the chance to, not even meeting people from Mongolia, but like watching contents made from Mongolia, you know, the cultural products, have any experiences with Mongolia in general. So when you talk about Mongolian in Japan, the community, the people, like I have no experiences to discuss this, my impressions to begin with. And it's not just Mongolia, but a lot of countries. For example, when we are in Japan, we met a lot of students from Uzbekistan, and my whole life I've never known what is the country is like, who are the people who live there, and what are their culture like. So I guess it's just the experiences of being outside of your country for the first time and being in a new environment and meeting new people. You get the chance to interact and engage with a lot of people from different backgrounds, and slowly you learn a lot about how is it like in another land far away. You know, that's kind of impression. So I hope I learn more about Mongolia, the country, the people, your experiences, especially in your life and in Japan from this episode. So perhaps let's bring the discussion to our two guests.
Yeah. Anyone want to jump in here? Maybe some initial thoughts in terms of what we were saying?
Yeah, that's great. Like in the first time, like when I come into Japan in the first time, like not actually like from, actually even the, in the TIU, not so many people doesn't really know about the Mongolia, like in even the foreign people. Because when I was coming to Japan, it was like 2015. And in the TIU, there was only four Mongolian students who were studying at that time. And actually, they are all from the my like high school, the senpais they were studying in the TIU. So like when I going to TIU, like actually in the UTRAC students, they were doesn't really know about the Mongolia. Like when I just meeting with them, they were saying, "Oh, you are the first person that I met from Mongolia. Like how you looks like the Korean or so. Like I'm sorry, I'm looks like a Mongolian, isn't it? Like oh no, you looks like a Chinese right now. Like." Oh God! Like that was like the totally like their first time to meeting with the Mongolian. So, yeah, for now it's like around 20 Mongolians are studying in a TIU right now.
Interesting. Unda, what about you? You have any thoughts about, you know, the impression? I guess the wider impression of. The Mongolian community in Japan. I mean, maybe you guys have some insight as to the population. How many Mongolians actually come to Japan, and you know, how big is that population?
So in this case, like the Mongolian population is around 3 million people are actually in Mongolia, and from the 3 million people right now in Japan, approximately around 6,000 Mongolians are living in Japan right now.
Well, yeah, Mongolia has become a democratic country as of the 1990s, and since then a lot of ministries of foreign countries have opened up in Japan. So it's not inaccurate to say that Mongolia is a newly democratic country, and a lot of these social, cultural, and educational exchanges have been they're on the process to on their way to making them their ways across the world. And Japan is definitely one of the countries that Mongolia has the best bilateral relations with. And as Oyunkhuu said, when he came to the Tokyo International University, there were not that many Mongolian students. And by the year I came to Japan, which was 2019, I've definitely gotten to know a lot of Japanese, a lot of Mongolians living in Japan. So I guess that is definitely one of the clear indications that like a lot of Mongolians are interested in Japan, and they are starting to live in Japan, and etc.
Yeah, on that note, actually, since you went in a little bit about the subject, I feel like with my, you know, with my outstanding introduction about you guys, I don't feel like I gave justice to you, to the backgrounds of you guys in terms of how you guys ended up coming to Japan. So maybe we can talk about that. You know, Unda, maybe you can go on a little bit about your journey. What made you decide to come to Japan in the first place? When did that happen? Shed some light on that, and then we'll jump to Oyun for the same question.
Well, in Mongolia, since the age of 17, I was working as the Secretary General to the United Nations Youth Advisory Panel. And we host the Model UNESCO conferences, which are simulations of the UNESCO General Assembly that we host in Mongolia. I got an invitation from the Kyoto Model United Nations Conference, and I was about to go to Japan in 2018, but I had some other conferences planned ahead, so I did not get the chance to go to Japan. But yeah, since then I have been actively pursuing Japan, and I used to work for a travel magazine called Vuvu, and I used to report a lot on like the tourism in Japan, even though I did not work there yet. And our magazine, we have published the governmental issue on the, I believe it was the 45th anniversary. Yeah, it was the 45th anniversary of diplomatic relations between Mongolia and Japan in 2017. And yeah, since then I've gotten to know a lot about Japan, and I've been interested in continuing my further education in Japan.
Long, you look like you want to say something, or should I jump in?
I was gonna say that.
You know, on the subject of MUN, you know, we're no strangers to that either. Have we been to Kyoto MUN? Longda, I can't recall, to be honest.
In Kobe, I think. But were you with us? I don't remember if you were with us, but we went to Kobe.
Interesting.
Kobe, not Osaka, Kobe. Yeah. I think that was Kobe.
Yeah, and Unda, you know, You're a journalist now. So how did that journey start for you? Why did you decide to go down that path, if I may ask?
Well, to be honest, it wasn't necessarily a passion of mine, but English was definitely one of my strong suits. And I basically noticed the market gap in journalists that could report in English. And that is also, I'm fairly young. Only 20 years old right now, and I have climbed quite a bit on the media and publications ladder throughout the past 5 years, and I definitely believe that it was due to the lack of qualifiable, also credible English journalists in Mongolia. And after working as the English English editor for the Mongolian Economy magazine, I have started working as the Japan correspondent, so I definitely believe that my pseudo knowledge, not my pseudo knowledge, but my English knowledge and my knowledge of international relations and the economy, etc., have definitely led me to kind of climb higher on the journalistic journey of mine.
Well, I mean, you certainly sound like an esteemed kind of experienced journalist. You've got the voice for a news reporter, if I may say. Like, it's, you know, just the tone of voice and everything, you've got it nailed down, if you don't mind me saying. But yeah, thanks for being on the show. Oyun, maybe we can talk a little about your background. I mean, I know you came to Tokyo International University, which is where I got to meet you as well as Long. And you studied business economics, if I'm not mistaken.
No, I used to study the international relations.
International relations. Okay, you were the same group as us. Okay. But what I found interesting and what I learned today, actually, is based on your bio, you started off as a web developer. Am I mistaken, or?
The web developer, when I was like studying at the TIU, like I did an internship with the IT company, and that was like one of my part-time job. So
oh, okay.
I was like doing developing webs and during those time.
And do you have background in web coding and that sort of thing? Or is it like something more?
Yes, like actually I doesn't have really have a rich experience for the web developing, but actually I was like used to working at the C program, so actually working with the web page and making the designs on it and the making reports on the company. So that was like my duty and doing it every day.
Right. And yes. And why did you decide to come to Japan?
So that's actually a really long story. And
feel free to go in deep.
When I was in Mongolia in my high school, I used to study in the Japanese style of the high school. And that time was, I met with so many Japanese people, and that was so great. And meeting with the Japanese people and how they are acting and even their culture was really interesting. So, actually, I'm made up myself like for that. I really wanted to go for a study in Japan. So I was like asking myself, like, where should I go? And I had like two choices. One of was like I was like going to study in United States. But actually, that time I really doesn't want to go for it when I taking a step from the university from the California, mm-hmm. like one of those university. Then I choose the TIU over it. Because that I like the Japanese culture and the people, and how they are treating with the people are communicating in this really unique. So I decided to come to Japan.
Yep. Long, how about you jump in here? I just got a little thing I have to fix here.
Okay, that's fine. Yeah. I feel there's a. Impressions just for me, and having made friends with Buzz and Russia and everyone else, that in a lot of cases we came to Japan because we have the engagement with Japanese pop culture growing up, you know, animes and all this cartoon and but if from both of your stories, is there's like impression for me is that anime, all this soft power, the cultural products of Japan didn't play an important role in your how you come to Japan, perhaps.
Yeah, it's more like, especially in Oyun's case, I'm getting the impression that, you know, your experience talking to Japanese people, your experience with the Japanese style of learning, all of those things helped gravitate you towards the prospect of living there. So on that note, you know, I know that you're also fluent in Japanese, you work for a global trust network, of course, so you know, what about Unda, do you speak Japanese as well, or what's your grasp on the language? We can't hear. I think you're muted, actually. Yeah.
Oh, I apologize for
no
that.
No worries.
Yeah.
No problem.
The Japanese grammar structures and etc. are very similar to Mongolian, but I am not my Japanese isn't as well as Oyun's, or I am probably at an introductory level, but I have enough Japanese understanding to basically get along in Japan.
Okay, interesting. So, you know, would you, based on the notorious N scale, how would you put yourself in terms of like N5 to N1? You know, how would you, because I would describe myself around N3 probably, you know, in terms
and
of my
I'll,
speaking.
I'll be probably around N6, so.
Are you familiar with that test?
Yeah, I would actually place myself lower than all of you guys. Oyun, who knows me personally, he knows that my Japanese isn't that well, but it's definitely something I should work on, especially.
No. You cannot go lower than N6. Listen, I declare N6 so that I have like the glass floor so that nobody can go below, you know? So. But if you say that you have experiences in the languages and can carry yourself in real life a bit comfortably, then I would say that'd be around N5 and 4, and that's better than me already. So,
I mean, don't be so harsh on yourself, Long. I mean, you can still order a meal in the restaurant. That's all you need, you know. If you can do that, then you're good to go. But in all seriousness, Oyun, tell me, you know, how did your Japanese learning experience begin? You know, when did you start learning? Did you start learning before you went to Japan, or was it all when you started going day one?
Actually, I studied Japanese when I was in high school. That was, I used to say that I was learning there for 3 years for Japanese. Then actually that time was, I wasn't really focusing on the Japanese skill. I was taking a Japanese classes, but what I'm doing was just doing the math and the physics. So I actually really liked those kind of subjects that time. So I just like canceling all my Japanese classes that time and focusing on those ones. But like when I came to Japan, all I needed was the Japanese skill, but I was so regret for it. So when I was taking the classes, it was like all of them in Japanese. So that time I really doesn't understand what the professor is saying in the lecture. So that moment I realized that I really need to learn the Japanese and really well. So started to learning the Japanese for every day and doing stuff. But it helped me a lot like during those times. So.
And how did you start studying? How did that experience go? Like, how much time did you commit, and what were the ways you learned the language?
The learning Japanese, like, basically every day I was like learning for 3 or 4 hours and communicating with so many people in Japanese, so that might help me. But after the second year, I really doesn't the focusing on the Japanese, so that was like everything was like going automatically, communicating with the people.
Yeah, and it was interesting going back to something that Unda said about the Mongolian sentence structure or grammar structure being similar to Japanese. Do you feel that way as well? I mean, did that kind of help you grasp concepts in the language easier than you anticipated? Oyun?
Oh, you asked me? Sorry.
Yeah.
I thought you were asking from the Undariya.
My bad.
Yeah. Sorry, what was the question again? I didn't like...
My bad. So I was just asking about the Japanese like grammar structure kind of being similar to Mongolian grammar structure based on what Unda was saying. So do you feel the same way? Like the similarities in the languages, did you feel like that helped you grasp, you know, Japanese grammar faster than you anticipated?
Yes, that's true. Like when I was thinking in Mongolian, so when I just putting the words in the same grammar, so it's the Japanese grammar and the Mongolian grammar are pretty similar. So that helped me a lot. Actually, it's like helping to all the Mongolians to learning Japanese a little bit the faster.
Yeah, that's interesting. Yeah, because I would say, you know, I speak Arabic as a mother tongue, so I would say that, you know, the grammar structure compared to Japanese is quite different. I mean, I think the way I see Japanese is like, I don't understand the meaning of the sentence until we reach the very end of the sentence. You know, like I can't grasp the context until I get to the end. I don't know. I just always had that impression.
Same for me as well. Yeah.
Yeah. While in Arabic, it's like I hear it starts with the main point and then it goes on with the rest, you know? So I always found that interesting. But, you know, I thought going back to Unda, I'm really interested about what, you know, a Japanese correspondent from who's working for a Mongolian agency or a magazine, what does that entail? Like, you know, how do you cover stories? What's the kind of, you know, Mongolian perspective on Japanese affairs? You know, give us a little taste about what it's like to do your job. You know, I'm quite curious about that.
Well, I believe, yeah, since 2015, Mongolia and Japan had the memorandum of commandment, and Japan is, Mongolia is landlocked, we're sandwiched between between Russia and China, which are two world global powers. So Mongolia has this policy called the Third Neighbor Policy that was developed in Washington some years ago, and Japan is definitely the best third neighbor that Mongolia has. We have a lot of educational exchanges, cultural and scientific exchanges. Well, there are a lot of Mongolia and Japan events in that regard, but I've arrived in Japan in 2018, and since then I've reported on the Shinzo Abe visit to Mongolia and kind of the bilateral relations between the two countries. And this year I've mostly been reporting on the global pandemic, and there are a lot of Mongolians in Japan, and Oyunkhuu has actually given me an interview on that article called Mongolians in Japan during the pandemic, because there are a lot of Mongolians that are stuck in Japan.
Interesting.
But I definitely plan on expanding my work to more I don't want to work concentrate too much on the political aspect, because the two embassies already provide us with enough information, and we have a lot of contact with the embassies as well. But I want to further, when I come back to Japan, I want to work more on the social relations that Mongolia and Japan has. So,
yeah, that's very interesting. I mean, to add to that, you know, the Mongolian community, like many foreign communities in Japan right now, they're kind of stuck in between a rock and a hard place, you know, depending on where they're from. You know, they might have difficulties seeing their families or coming back home. You know, what's the situation in Mongolia with the pandemic? I haven't heard much about what's the state of affairs going on there. Is it a critical situation? Is it better than most? Maybe you guys, this is a question directed to both of you. Maybe you guys can share more about
perhaps you can allow us to have a peek at your interview earlier about Mongolian in Japan during pandemic. I mean, I'm interested, and I'm sure Buzz and the audience
in the question, Undariya might give the best answer, because she went back to Mongolia and stayed, experienced all the quarantine and everything there.
Oh, yeah, well, actually, I came to Japan this year on the last regular flight. So right after the Prime Minister gave the order to cancel flights with Japan, I was on the last plane to from Mongolia to Japan. And during that time, everybody in Mongolia was wearing masks. And as you know, Mongolia is one of the worst Mongolia's air pollution is 4 times worse than Beijing, so the level is beyond hazardous. And during that time, like as much work I have done for the UN, nobody wore masks. But during news of Corona at that time, that was my perception, everybody started wearing masks. And during that time, I was kind of critical of the Mongolian citizens as they did not wear masks when the air pollution level was beyond hazardous, but they start wearing masks when there is a disease that hasn't even arrived in Mongolia yet. And I have published an article that was quite critical at that time. And when I came back to Japan, everything was fine. Everybody was nobody was doing social distancing. Everybody was continuing their normal social life as usual. And yeah, when I
and are you talking Japan, about the entire Japanese community, or are you talking about the Mongolian community in Japan?
Oh, the entire Japanese community. I'm just talking about how Mongolia took. Well, at the first stages, I thought Mongolia was being too dramatic, but seeing from the current situation now, Mongolia did take the appropriate measures, because Mongolia does not have the proper medical capacity to handle such a pandemic in such a way where Japan would, for instance. But as of now, there are currently, I believe there was about like 100 infections, but all of them got cured, and there are no in-state Corona infections, and all of them came through the chartered flights, and all of them have been cured. So there actually has been an article that was released in the Western press saying that despite the fact that there is zero coronavirus in Mongolia, the economy is paying for it, because we did have to shut out a lot of our trade routes and etc. So yeah, in Mongolia there is absolutely no corona. People stopped wearing masks at this point, and everything is continuing as usual, but the economy is suffering a lot.
Yeah, that's not the 100 cases. That's not a bad number at all. When I compare it to where I'm living right now, I live in Qatar. We have about 200 cases a day until now. Hearing it from my perspective, it doesn't sound so bad. But of course, it does have the immediate economic implications that we kind of forget sometimes. Excuse my ignorance, but you know, I actually didn't know that fact about Mongolian pollution. I did not know it was worse than Beijing. Actually, I did not hear about that. I'm interested, Percy. I mean, maybe you're more aware about the subject, but
yes,
it's new to me. Why is that? What's the industry that dominates Mongolia right now?
Actually,
that's kind of contributing to that.
Question, I think it coincides with what Bastian just asked on the chat 20 minutes ago. He asked, Mongolia is quite a large country. Is there any industry in Mongolia? And you know, and he mentioned industry that Mongolia is famous for, example, cars, you know, for just an example, can educate us.
Well, Mongolia is not that well industrialized. We mostly sell primary resources such as our coal. We exported to China and our natural resources, etc. And that also contributes to the earlier fact that I stated, where we have our two neighbors are two of the largest producers in the world. So probably due to the dumping and our lack of anti-dumping legislations, we do get a lot of our goods from China and Russia. But it's mainly due to the capital city, Ulaanbaatar, and 70% of the people, they live in the Gir districts, which is the Mongolian huts that people live in, and they burn coal. Majority of households that live in the capital city, they burn coal. The way the structure of the capital city is also built is we are in the midst of 4 large mountains, so we cannot really blow away most of our air pollution. So yeah,
Very
with majority population burning coal.
And you're both, are you both from the capital? Or?
Yeah, we're
yeah. Okay, interesting.
It must be a completely different experience when you come to Japan, I assume, because I also come from a city, or rather a country where there's a lot of pollution in the big city. So when I came to Japan, the first impression was, wow, this is so clean, the air, the temperature, the weather is so nice, especially around this time as well.
I can relate to that too.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah, you from Qatar and it's very hot over there.
Yeah, hot, humid, and yeah, plenty of pollution from our side. But yeah, I can definitely relate. When I went to Japan, the air quality was significantly different. I don't know, you can sense something about it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But perhaps our guests can share some stories about how did they adjust to their lives in Japan when they first came? What are the impressions that you had of Japan, and how has it changed since then? What is something that is memorable to you about Japan?
Yeah, maybe in like your first year, something that stood out to you, maybe like a culture shock, you know, or something along those lines.
Yeah, let's share stories.
Who's gonna go first?
Oyun, maybe we can start with you.
Maybe you can say.
Yeah, they're sharing memories when I'm coming to Japan in the first time.
Yeah. Like something like, that stands out to you.
Yeah, it's like when I'm coming to Japan in the first time was the 5 years ago, and I really like amused at that time, like because I came to Japan in the first time and the people were so different, and how they are the greeting with the in the airport, that was like really surprised me. And even when I go to like in convenience store and the people were saying, oh, thank you very much, please come back again, like actually that was not really common in Mongolia. So I saw that the moment, and that was like really impressive at that time. So actually in Japan, I came in around the February, there was a winter. So actually in Mongolia it's a really cold, it's the minus 40 degrees in the Celsius and during the coldest time. So when I coming to Japan, it was the around the 5 degree or 10 degrees. That was so warm and a really nice place, and I liked it. Mm. How was it like, Undaria, for you?
You guys may regard me as a bumpkin for saying this, but when I came to Narita International Airport, I actually came to Japan in August 2019. And at that time, I asked the lady for something, and somebody just says, and the airport staff said, I'm busy, and she ran off. And when I was trying to get like a SIM card, a temporary one, I asked, what if I don't return it? And then the lady said, well, I don't feel that comfortable renting it out to you because you of the earlier comment you said. And there was like a lot of cultural differences between Mongolia and Japan. And before coming, I definitely knew the work I would be doing and the life I would be living. But for Mongolia, it's kind of, Japan is like a settler civilization. Mongolia is a nomadic civilization. And yeah, Japan has this, many Mongolians really like Japan, but some Mongolians, they don't like the part about Japan where like, if you enter a room, you have to close the door. Because they don't understand that. Because perhaps due to our vast land and like, etc. They don't really need this. They don't really like understand the point of avoiding inconveniences for other people. But for Japan, it's like a lot of people living on a tiny island. So you have to like do your part to limit inconveniences for other people. As for Mongolia, you don't have to get along with your neighbor. If you don't like them, you're going to move 5,000 kilometers away, and that's the end of that. So it was definitely a bit interesting for me to adjust to in Japan because I did not understand the directness of the people. And you know, you in Mongolia, you could go into a store and like talk to the shopkeeper like you've known them for years. But yeah, that's definitely something I've had to adjust to, I would say.
Yeah, I really like that parallel you drew there about, you know, how you can go into a store and kind of speak to someone who's familiar, and like you can actually have a conversation. And I can also see where Oyun's coming from about, you know, appreciating that dedication to professionalism and respect, you know, from a surface in terms of what you know, that kind of customer service in Japan is something that I have not seen anywhere else. I've been to Europe, I've been to the Middle East, I've been to the Americas. I have not seen that anywhere in my life except in Japan, which is something very unique there. But at the same time, I can see where you're coming from. In terms of it also feels a little bit artificial, because it feels like they're putting a kind of like a barrier, like an invisible barrier, where they're maintaining that professional boundary. While I do appreciate it, it's at the same time, if something goes awry, it's so difficult to communicate with them because they're maintaining this, you know, kind of persona rather than more of just a normal human being. So yeah, I don't know how I feel about it. At one hand, I really like Japan's like customer service, but at the same time, you know, when something goes wrong in my experience and you need something fixed, it's so difficult to actually talk to someone and get them to understand your situation. And you know, on that subject, you know, as someone who's working with GTN, you deal with customers all the time, Oyun. Maybe you can tell us a bit about your experience, you know, managing foreigners in Japan, or like you're speaking to people about, you know, career prospects, right? So I had those sessions where, you know, they come and they kind of give you some advice on what's the best foot forward. Tell us about some of your stories. Maybe you have some interesting stories to share. Do you ever face like confrontation, or do you have to deal with like some people who are a bit difficult to deal with, you know? Give us a little bit of those insights of what it's like to work for GTN.
Thank you very much. So working in the GTN is actually so interesting for me, like, because there are already like in 300 people actually working in the GTN, and 70% of them all from the abroad. So the basically the company atmosphere is like really the global, the field. So the working in the GDN, like I used to work in the life support department in the first time. So during those times, it's like people who are living in the apartments, we are taking care of them and they guarantee them. So basically what I'm doing was the helping them to, if they have like any kind of the problem with the living and stuff, so we are helping to them, like, because like when they needed to call to the gas company or the electricity company, so every single problem we they're helping to the people. So the basically when I like working there, like every single minute is there is a the phone is the ringing. So when I taking the phone call, there is the one the customer who is have like the problem. So after like the helping them, like giving the assistance, they all always being like an appreciating, and those things were really they're giving me motivation for working in that field. So at least we are doing something for the people who are going to be the grateful, and they're coming to Japan, they makes them like easier, because if the person doesn't know about the Japanese language, so it's a little bit difficult to the communicating with the other companies. So right now I'm working in the work consultants. So the people after they're graduating from the universities or when they're coming to Japan, we are helping to people to find a job. So whenever they like wanted to find the like ideal job, we are giving them advice and how to make a great job and how to write all the Japanese style of the CV, and we are introducing the companies they might be interested in.
Unda, have you ever had to employ the service of GTN before during your life in Japan?
Yeah, I had the GTN pocket Wi-Fi, and I guess that's a part of GTN Mobile. Yeah, they're Shinokubo offers.
True.
Yeah.
I GTN remember those trips to Shinokubo.
Shinokubo, the legendary place.
Is that where you work, Oyun? Do you have to go to Shinokubo as well?
I used to work in the Shinokubo before, but now I'm working in the Ikebukuro. The central office is located in Ikebukuro.
Yeah. So, and like,
So.
do you, I mean, what are, like, I'm sure you get these. I'm sure you get weird, requests or, kind of strange, askings of help on the phone during your job. Yeah, because like you said, GTN, they're quite broad. Like, they help you with almost everything, just life in Japan, life support in Japan.
Yeah.
I've called them for almost everything because they're just quite convenient in that sense. So, tell us maybe what's the weirdest request you've received from a customer in your experience? Like, well, I'm sure you have some kind of weird request in mind.
I don't know, like, should I like stay here or not?
Or are you breaching
But yeah,
customer
like
privacy?
I took the one the a little bit the where the request. So there were actually the one the guy I was like the helping for him, like supporting him in like every day, like he had a like kind of the problem. So during that time, like the person was like calling to every day, and they wanted to like they're asking one of my coworker, like I'm like interesting with that the person, can you help me to go for a date with her? Like that's a little bit impossible. If you want to interest in, you can go for it like yourself. Like why are you asking for me like on the work phone? That was a little bit
For real? Someone actually tried to do that?
Wait, did they
So
ask you
basically
for like
what he
language
did was like,
support?
yeah, like he was asking me like the language support, like can you tell him I'm interested with her, please let her know, like in Japanese, thank you, like dude, no. That
Wow, that's quite the
was like
outgoing
a little bit
gentleman.
funny and interesting at the same time.
That's fascinating. I'm sure you. I mean, I've had friends who've asked GTN for strange things every now and then. So I'm sure you have plenty of those stories. I want to come back to specifically the Mongolian community in Japan for a sec, and just ask like, I'm familiar with the fact that a lot of Mongolians who come to Japan, they come and live in areas of Tokyo, specifically, I believe Nerima and the other place is Sugamo. I think they're kind of a close-knit community, are they not? Like they tend to be around those parts, and I've also heard, that a lot of them come for studies more than work. I mean, maybe you guys can share, what do you guys know about that? What do most people come to Japan for from Mongolia? Do they come for studying and then work, or is it specifically work? Maybe this is a question posed to Unda first.
Well, I would say it's more kind of like a 50-50 situation. There are definitely a lot of Mongolian students that do study in various Japanese universities, both in English and Japanese. But there are those blue-collar labor works, such as those little assembling factories, iron factories, and etc. I have gotten to know a lot of blue-collar employees that come to Japan with work visas and etc. And they stay in Japan for a few years, save up, and then they come back to Mongolia. And there are obviously some, such as Oyo, who are white-collar employees who do work and live in Japan. I would say it's, well, there are. I don't know if I'm allowed to say this. Probably I am, since it's like a casual thing. A lot of people who illegally immigrated to Japan as well. So it's mainly students, and after that, it's blue collar employees and white collar employees, and there are illegal immigrants as well, I would say.
Yeah, and what's the kind of conversion rate or turnover rate where how many people from Mongolia come to Japan to study or work, and how many of them go back? Like, how many of them actually stay? Because this seems to be kind of a prevalent thing with, you know, foreigners coming to Japan. Whenever we talk to anyone, I mean, I'm one of them, is that, you know, we come to Japan with prospects of study or work, and then we end up kind of, you know, struggling to find our place or struggling with other factors, and then we end up just going back to where we came from. You know, what is it like for Mongolians? Do most of them stay, or, you know, the other way?
Am I answering first?
You can go ahead.
You can go ahead. Yeah.
Well, if I say this, I might sound like I'm complimenting Mongolians, but you know those like general soft skills? I think Mongolians are very good at that. So most Mongolians that come to, like, we, okay, this is not like official off the stats or anything, but generally Mongolians, they come to Japan, they have no clue what's going on. They generally figure their way out. And this also, and it's not only with Japan, it may be with like a lot of the other countries that Mongolians migrate to. And it's because the situation, living standards in Mongolia, etc., life in Mongolia is kind of not as easy as it is in Japan, etc. So if they, and it's hard for the embassies to give them visas as well. So if they are abroad, then I think they really do like do whatever they can to make sure they stay there with most of the people. But I mean, I think Oyun would definitely have a lot more to say on this area, as he is a career consultant.
So the, here's the thing is, like, the most of the Mongolians, like, according to the research, they are most of them like coming to Japan because of their wanted to study here. The first of the one of their the main reason is the higher education in Japan, and all one of those things are really the important. Then after that, they wanted to gain experience like in Japan and working here 1 or 2 years. Then after that, like the most of them, like going back to Mongolia for the working and making their own career in Mongolia. So this is their actually the main reason. And also, this not so many people are just like staying in Japan like for their whole time here. Yes.
I think it's the same for any group who comes to Japan, I guess. They share the same story of, I mean, in the end, it all depends on how your background and what it's like when you first came to the country. You know, you have your own goals that you want to achieve in the country, whether it's education, work experiences, money, and yeah, but I guess now that we have this pandemic, everything just kind of like go into haywire.
Yeah. I'm just a little bit conscious of time. I believe we've been live now for about 50 minutes. So Oyun, Unda, I mean, it's a pleasure. Thank you so much for joining us today. It's been a really interesting discussion, actually. I mean, do you have any thoughts or stories you'd like to share with the audience before we conclude this? I mean, maybe something about, you know, what's your future aspirations for Mongolians in Japan, or maybe, you know, just about the pandemic, since it's something that's affecting us all even today. So, you know, maybe some your thoughts on what's to come in the future, maybe on an individual level or for Mongolians living in Japan in general. Unda, maybe we can start with you.
Well, alongside the journalism, I have started working on the first actually e-commerce project between Japan and Mongolia, where they're importing Mongolian products to Japan and I guess for Mongolia, that would definitely be a good kickstart to the economy. We're about to launch starting January. And for Japan, then Japan would get like the opportunity to get like raw natural products that with minimal designs and like no chemical ingredients and like no natural waste and etc. So for starters, I'm working on that alongside the journalism stuff, and I guess with e-commerce and trade between the two countries, given the trade benefits they've been giving to each other, I guess, well, for me, I'm just waiting to see on where that goes for me and for the two countries.
Sounds fascinating. Keep us updated on that. If you have any links or resources on the project, we'd be happy to share them with our community as well. So, you know, feel free to share that with us. We'll be happy to share that. It sounds very interesting. Oyun, anything from your end?
Yes. First of all, like, thank you, Long, and the Buzz, like, for inviting for this the beautiful podcast. So it was like very interesting the topics we are discussing for today. And actually, as I mentioned for the before, the like staying in Japan, at least what we studied in Japan and knowing the Japanese culture and the knowing the Japanese people and making a lot of friends. So that once we having a, just like a praying for the global peace and making a lot of like more the thing for needed for all the people like who needed in the world. So just making for the peace. Yeah.
Indeed.
Yeah, it's a wonderful message to end this on. Oyu Unda, it's been such a pleasure. Thank you so much for joining us. And a big thank you to everyone that tuned in. Don't forget to like and follow Bento Bureau on Facebook and Instagram and YouTube, which is where we stream today. And feel free to let us know your thoughts and suggestions by sending us a message or leaving a comment in the chat. And don't forget to like this video, of course. Show some support if you want more from Bento Bureau. We'll be back soon. Thank you so much. And if you enjoyed this stream, subscribe to us as well for more talks like this. Have a lovely Saturday, everyone. This is Bento Bureau signing off. Let me switch to the three Bastion. Co-hosts here. Bastion, you ready to say goodbye? It was a fruitful discussion, wasn't it? Bastion, you there? There you go, Bastion. Sing to your heart's content.
We agree with you. I think you are ending this.
Fantastic.
Nice. No,
Bastion. Gosto samadeshita, everybody. Have a lovely Saturday.